But first, I want to express how happy I am. And privilege to be able to contribute to this conference. I read some of your work, and your work, Professor Parsons, inspired my understanding and the way I understand Robinson. And okay, so first, I mean, this is the context of the of my talk. First, I talk a little bit about Robinson and his work. It's okay now? Okay. Then about his philosophical change, because he changed his position, his philosophical point of view. And I think that that intuition has a huge role in his change of his philosophical position. So I talk about intuition of object, intuition of concept, which is different in his work. And in the conclusion, I'll talk about some another thinking about Robinson's points of view. Okay? Okay. So, the introduction. Okay. I try to speak. I hope that it is okay now. Okay. No. Before. Okay. Now the table is too small. Okay, so Formalism 64 is the name of a lecture that Abraham Robinson gave in Jerusalem in 1964. In his lecture, Robinson laid out his philosophical beliefs, claiming that as a result of the changes that mathematics and logic had undergone in the 60s, I mean at the beginning of the 60s, it was no longer possible to intuitively grasp the world of sets. And it is very important for him. I'll show why. And this is a quote of the continuum hypothesis. And he said the continuum hypothesis, putting out that it is neither provable nor refutable in accepted axiomatic set theory, and that, in this case, the question cannot be settled either by an intuitive argument or by any other argument. Okay. I will talk about this more later. Robinson thus stated that he could no longer hold a Platonistic view of the world, a standpoint which assumed the existence of mathematical object independent of our mind, but nevertheless accessible to us. Robinson said, he said, if one faced with a mathematical concept that one believes to be categorical as an absolute sense, then one will naturally be upset when confronted with a sentence X, which is meaningful for a theory under consideration, and such that both X and not X are consistent with all assumption which seems intuitively correct with regard to the structure or universe in question. Okay? By making this surprising statement, Robinson declared himself as a formalist, a follower of Hilbert school, but actually in many of his articles, he claimed that his followers not only of Hilbert school, but also as Leibniz. he mentioned Kant many times, but especially Leibniz and Hilbert. Okay. He was a student of Frankel, of Abraham Frankel's student, Robinson, and he was influenced by his philosophy. And Abraham Frankel was a Platonist. And Abraham Robinson wrote in his math articles many times that he wrote them from a Platonist point of view. Okay. Before Formalism 64, I have to change. Exactly. Robinson was a Platonist, believing that there are a single world of sets, which could also serve as a basic for other mathematical fields. The view that there is a single world of sets was largely accepted by the mathematical community of the time. That's what Robinson said himself, that it was largely accepted. Okay? And he said, as long as is a prit, the accepted axiomatic system of set theory, such as system of ZF, were able to cope with all set theoretical problems which are of interest at a working mathematician. Belief in the existence of unique universe of set was almost an animus. The declaration in 64 that he was a formalist was surprising, since Robinson was well aware of Gödel's incomplete sentences, which hit the defense of the formalist and Robinson program in particular. As a result of Gödel's sentences, the system of natural number and every strong enough formal system is consistent or complete, but not both. Okay? And I don't know if I need to read the quotation. Well, this is one of them. There are many. When he said that he was aware of Gödel incomplete sentences. Okay. Gödel's result didn't alarm Robinson's, since for him they were examples of a sentences which is intuitively true, although which cannot be proved formally in a finite number of steps. Moreover, Robinson was sure that the Gödel sentences or any similar sentence, though unprovable and irrefutable within the given formal framework, can nevertheless be shown to be true. Informal but rigorous argument. And he says it also. Yes. The word, the informal but rigorous argument, is a quotation from Robinson, okay? He said it in an article in 1973. Yes, I wrote it here. Okay, but what pushed him to the arm of formalism? So what pushed him was Cohen results, which was, he was influenced from Cohen a lot, and also from his forcing technique. So what finally pushed Robinson into arms of formalism was Cohen's independent results. Cohen proved the consistency of ZF and the negation of the continuum axiom. In this way, Cohen results completed the independent proof of the continuum axiom, which Gödel had begun a few years earlier when he demonstrated the consistency of the ZF with the continuum, with the the ZF with the continuum. He posited this. The situation in set theory is now analog with the historical development of Euclidean geometry. And the parallel axiom, which is independent of the remaining axiom. This is also an example that Robinson himself gave. Okay? He did, he compared the situation in set theory with the situation in geometry then. Okay? Or today also. The other quotation that I put is that's why he in many of his articles, okay, he describe conversation between a Platonist and a formalist, okay? The Platonist, sometimes he called him P, and sometimes in many other articles he called him G, okay? And the formalist was sometimes, most of the time R, sometimes F, but most of the time R. Okay? Mm-hmm. And he described their conversation. So here, in this quotation, he said why finally he decided to be a formalist, and this is because all the independence results, but also he said that now he is not sure that maybe, and that's what he said, someone will find a sentence that is independent, but there is no way, never, I mean, to find if it's consistent, I mean, it's a to decide his truth value, okay? He tried to, okay, I read it, okay? And he said, P is persuaded that there are absolutely unknowable sentences in either C theory or arithmetic. He will realize that he must either give up his philosophy or accept the existence of unknowable truth, and he may well opt for the form. For the former, okay? Although he considered himself a formalist, Robinson's formalism was quite different from that of Hilbert. I don't want to enter, very deep to his formalism, because this is not, I don't want to talk about it today, but for example, Robinson accepted the use of non-countable affirmation, such as a Cohen forcing technique, but in very high infinite. And he has a forcing himself, a forcing technique himself. In addition, Robinson didn't believe that the formal system has to be meaningless. Thus, he devised method to incorporate semantic and syntactic within the same a system. I will talk about it later. Okay? Another difference between Robinson and Hilbert pertains to the rejection of the absolute infinite, but from a different reason. Although both of them reject the absolute infinite, the reasons for doing so were different. Hilbert totally rejects this concept both in reality and in our consciousness. Thus, the absolute infinite is a deception of the mind, and one day when our thought will be very clear, we will be able to translate every infinite claim into finite one, Robinson thought differently. He made a connection between ontology and epistemology. Only our understanding can determine if something exists. Okay? An understanding is not, doesn't have to be finite. Okay. And I'll also talk about understanding later. The infinite totalis don't have any detailed meaning. Okay? Meaning was very important to him. Okay. Therefore, since the absolute infinite cannot be understood, it does not exist. This does not mean that it will not be understood and thus exist in the future. Okay? In Robinson's philosophy, the human conscious is at the center, and only what can be perceived by us can exist for him. This formalism enabled him to maintain his belief in the harmony between being and knowledge. Okay? And he said this quotation of him, as far as I know, only a small minority of mathematicians, even those with Platonist view, accept the idea that there may be mathematical facts which are true but unknowable. Okay. As I have already stated, the harmony between being and knowledge comes at the expense of giving up what may be called epistemological optimism. Okay. I don't think that, okay, so we are not here yet. Okay, so, but the concept of epistemological optimism is a concept which I learned from my tutor, from Professor Posey. The term is associated with the feature that human intelligence that is responsible for the design of theories and reason activities. The concept is related specifically to the part of our personality that needs a complete picture of that field and that we are dealing with. In the view that Hilbert, Godel, and Robinson, this concept is related to our desire to complete the picture of mathematics, and that all mathematical problems will eventually be resolved. Robinson gave up on epistemological optimism, stated that we cannot necessarily conclude that all mathematical facts will be accessible to us. Okay? That's what he said. I have a quotation that he said that one of his fear is that he will discover an absolutely undecidable sentence. Okay? Of elementary arithmetic. Okay. Gödel and as a Platonist and Hilbert as a formalist are both optimistic in every area of mathematics. Robinson, however, was not sure that the world of mathematics will ever be spread out before us. Okay? So Robinson gave up on Platonism because following Cohen's result, he could no longer intuitively grasp the world of set. And on this subject, I will talk very in details. Robinson distinguished between intuition of object and intuition of concept. I will now demonstrate why the world of set could not be grasped by either type of intuition. Okay? I'm sorry, but I have to. I'm Okay, now we can continue. Okay, so now what intuition of objects mean for him. So when he talk about objects, he relate objects with meanings. Okay? Intuition of objects and the world of set as an object. Okay? Robinson deals with the meaning of objects. The way Robinson viewed the meaning of an object is closer to the intuitionist position than Hilbert's formalist approach. Sometimes that's what I feel, but not exactly. Okay? But in many ways. I want to explain what intuition of object meant to Robinson, while the world of set cannot be grasped as an object and is therefore meaningless to this type of intuition, and why, as a result of this, and also because Robinson believes in the harmony between being and thought, he concluded that the world of set does not exist and as object. Okay. Robinson reaches his position using an empirical approach. It is here, the first quotation. And he said, in choosing my position, my approach has been empirical. That is to say, I have tried to take into account all the evidence available to me that may have a bearing on the subject. But he said that I choose my approach has been empirical. Okay? Included both basic thinking and technical results in logic and mathematics. Okay. According to Robinson, according to Robinson, when we can comprehend mathematical objects, we can grasp them exactly like we grasp physical objects, such as a house, tree, or sets of objects. We use sensory perception to understand concrete objects, but it appears that a kind of abstraction is involved at even the lower level of awareness of sensory objects. In order to sense perception, we are not directed to sensory material. We are directed instead toward particular objects that are experienced as identical. That is, an object that is formed or synthesized out of this type of intuition. The properties of an object that one grasps directly by our intuition yield the meaning of that object. Okay? That's what he means. This means that any meaningful question, and this is formalism, regarded the object will necessarily have a unique answer. So, recognizing an object fully makes us know that object. This is the, I wrote it, yes. And knowing an object assures us of its existence. From this perspective, there is a similarity between inquiry into mathematical and physical object. That's what he said. Okay? The intuition to which Robinson referred, at least the basic one, is the same as that of, I think, Kant's sensible intuition, even though the object that Kant talk about are naturally different. In any case, Robinson's intuition is epistemic and ontological. I think it's viewed by Kant. Okay, so, and he also talked about, you mentioned it earlier, degrees of understanding or degree of knowing. It's not of knowing. Knowing is when we know something fully, all its meaning. An object that cannot be grasped fully by intuition does not exist. Therefore, what does exist are single objects. I wrote it. Okay. Single objects and what Robinson called finite structure. Finite structures are either completed or single objects, or either composed of single objects or a finite extrapolation of single objects. Therefore, in a finite structure, we can point to each object that we can also grasp, and we can also grasp the structure as a whole. Mathematical objects exist for him in an objective way. And he said it like trees, houses, and so on. We can understand them in details. I mean, they are not physical objects, but they exist for him, even if he was a formalist. Okay. A mathematical object, as well as a finite set of objects, has a representation in the mathematician's brain. And there is physical. Okay, but anyway, there is a gap. He also talked about the gap between the finite and infinite object. I mean, the object that we grasp, that have meanings, and the object that doesn't have meanings. He didn't, you know, put the line. But he said in one example that that absolute infinite is not existent as an object because we cannot. But he gave another example, which is, and I see if I have the quotation here. No.
I think it was one slide back.
No, it's not here. Okay, so maybe I see. Yes. Any universal sentence, yes, of elementary arithmetic, for example, the sentence in Prandtl's normal form formula in the first order predicate calculus in terms of addition, multiplication, and equality, and containing universal quantifiers only, has a direct intuitive meaning, although it refers to unlimited domain of individual. Okay? Okay. When he was Platonist, as a Platonist, Robinson didn't have any problem accepting the existence of absolute infinite. Following Cohen results, the world of set was no longer actually can be grasped by him. It was not exist as an object. And why, he said? Because because he could split into two contradictory mathematical worlds. In the first world, there are more cardinals between alpha, fs, and 2, the power. And in the second world, there are no cardinals between those two other cardinals. The problem is that both of these worlds are intuitively to us in exactly the same way. And in this state, there is no way to decide which of the world exists. And he said that That's why, since the world of sets is meaningless, is not an object, okay? And now I want to explain why it is not a concept. Okay, so intuition of a concept, which is different than intuition of an object. And when he talked about concept, he used the word understanding and not meaning. Okay? Concept has, we understand. So, Robinson claims that the origin of intuition of concepts, just like intuition of objects, came from empirical experience, but not necessarily experience from the external world. For example, inference is an act of our mind, and truth statement refers to the external world. This world can be an ideal one. Okay? He talked a lot, even about abstractions and so on, but I don't want to go into it now. Okay? After we have grasped a concept by intuition, we want to understand it by reason. Robinson's opinion is that we understand the concept only when we can describe it by a set of axioms. The set of axioms bring out the essence of the concept. An essence is just an invariant or identity through variation. An essence means something objective and mind independent. It is important to emphasize that concepts do not need to have meaning in opposite to objects, which do. And I'll give examples, okay? But before that, I want to emphasize that concepts, have to be understandable. Okay, and that's why Robinson replied to mathematicians who hold the opinion that infinite sets are like finite sets. They are a collection of distinct objects. Sometimes they are, but this is not the way that we always need to understand them. Okay, now the connection between when concepts exist. Okay? So he said, when the set of axioms is complete, we not only understand the concept fully, but we also know the concept. Understanding a concept is a result of the actions of our mind, and there may be degree of understanding. The more the concept is clear to us, the better we understand it. And clear to us is we have more complete set of axioms. Okay? And he said so. When we fully understand the concept, we have knowledge. And when we know that concept, the concept not only exists in our mind, but also objectively and independently of our mind. There is no statement in about it which we cannot classify as true or false. Robinson used formal language and logic, which are the main tools of the formalist, in order to achieve Platonist goal, like uniqueness, maybe not, but truth and objectivity existence, and objective existence, okay? A complete formal system represents for Robinson a fully defined concept, a concept whose components are well understood by us. And as I said, Robinson believed that a well-defined concept is an objective which is opposite to subjective concept, a concept which is not fully defined. Since Robinson was interested in objectivity and therefore in objective concepts, he paid much attention to method for completing formal axiom system and to define tests for verifying completeness of formal system, okay, in his mathematical activities. Okay, now I want to give some example. An example of concept that we fully understand, okay? The concept of order and the closed real fields, algebraic real fields, okay? That's why the theories of complex and real number are decidable and complete. That's what happened is that strangely enough, while imagine that real numbers are more complicated than natural number n. But in actually, the theory of R, in terms of first order logic, it's much less complicated than the theory of n. In n, there are undecidable sentences, sentences which we cannot determine are truth or false. For example, there is no general procedure to figure out whether Goldenbach assumption, or it was Fermat once, is true or not. This is very much in contrast to R, in which every sentence is decidable. This is a way to provide some understanding into why Euclidean geometry is much easier to understand than number theory. When we have a complete set of axioms, the concept exists objectively for Robinson. Therefore, according to Robinson, existence and truth are connected to each other in relation to intuition of concept. Okay? And also the intuition of concept. Object, but in a different way. Okay. Now, why the world of set cannot be understood? I think it's very we can say because the world. The set of axioms which describe the world of set is not complete, and we know how to complete it. So the world of set doesn't exist as an axiom, according to Robinson. Okay? But I want to say some words about formal system, okay? Because, as I said earlier, a formal system is not have meanings, okay? And you see it as a limitation of the formal system. As and I relate to it, okay? So we have problem with the set of, with the world of set as an object and as a concept, and that's why he felt he cannot stay a Platonist anymore, and because all the other stuff, things that I said, but I will talk about it later, but now about formal system. Some word. The limitation of formal system is said, for instance, a formal system cannot describe and odd and the object, and he stayed behind the name, so I use his term. Okay? Sometimes an object is perceived intuitively, and our knowledge of it is more than its function in the system. Okay? For example, he said the number one is an object which we perceive by intuition. We know more about this number and its function in the system. And he said, why? More than that, for instance, Husserl intuition intuited number one differently than that of Hilbert or Powell. This different intuition cannot be depicted by formal system. A complete formal system describes a concept. A concept is the essence, the universal of the objective elements common to all the structures described by a complete set of axioms. However, it is impossible to avoid the intuitive content of mathematical object. So what Robinson did, I mean, he tried to take care of this problem, okay? And he thought that a name, okay, this is another object. Robinson believed that, a symbol in the formal system systems have a meaning which we cannot avoid. According to Robinson, semantics is part of mathematics, and it was therefore important for him to unite semantic and system and syntax into a single formal system. Robinson called this formal system diagram. A diagram of a mathematical set of element is the collection of all its atomic sentences or negation of its atomic sentences expressing all possible basic relationship between the set of elements. We may even assume that the relations and constants of the sets of elements actually belong to a formal language and denote themselves. Okay? For example, the diagram of the set of elements of the field of rational number will include sentences like 2 plus 2 is 4. Okay, so what we have in the diagram is the collection of very elementary sentences or their negation. And of course, you know, there is a problem because also we have, again, a formal system, and this is also a meaningful. So what he did, he said that we can we can again took all the describe every element. We took to the formal system all the elements. Okay, the name of all the elements of all the and we can take also all the simple sentences that describe the relationship. And I just want to mention that mathematicians believe in the objectivity truth of mathematical theorem because they believe in the objective existence of mathematical entities. Okay, a complete set of axioms has semantic as well as ontological importance. And now I'm finished. Wow, it took some, I thought that I'm very short. Wow. Okay. Oh. I'm sorry. I really was. Okay, I understand that. Okay, so I just, sorry. I was sure that I took only 20 minutes. So, okay, but so I'll finish. I just said that maybe, you know, I want to talk a little bit about the harmony, but I do something else. I just want to say that what amazed me all the time, that although he left Platonism, he used, he said that the goal of mathematics should be deeper understanding of its concept. Okay? That's what he thought, which is a Platonistic goal. And he didn't stop searching for a single mathematical world, okay, which exists. And that's, I mean, the last quotation is from a letter that he wrote to Gödel. Okay? They wrote letter to each other. When, okay? So I'm sorry, I didn't know that I, you know, I won't, that I'm afraid that I don't have.
Because it's a very interesting correspondence between the two, but I yes. think we'll have to stop because first, if Charles wants to cut some comment from this now, otherwise we'll go on.
Not much. I my knowledge of Robinson's philosophy was extremely sketchy, and you've filled in the sketch at a number of points. In one respect, I think it shows him as a figure of his time. Many people hold the opinion about the continuum hypothesis today, hold the opinion about the continuum hypothesis that he held, but with developments including large cardinals and their use to settle questions about descriptive set theory that had been shown in his time to be undecidable by Tamilo-Frankel set theory have at least spurred not just optimism but actual research programs, particularly Hugh Wooden's work. Don't know how that will turn out, but what what is a bit of a puzzle to me is complete theories that have no undecidable sentences can still have non-standard models, so it's not necessarily the case that the domain they're talking about is unique. I wonder whether Robinson's view of that phenomenon is recorded.
If I understand your question, you are talking about, for example, a Skolem result? That's what you mean? That
yeah,
we have...
Of course, that's a non-recursive theory that the non-standard models of complete arithmetic, but take the decidability of real closed fields. The theory of real closed fields has a variety of models. It's not.
Yes. Okay.
It doesn't establish the real numbers as a unique domain.
True. Yes. True. But he said that we know about them a lot. That's true that it's not a real domain, but it's a concept. It's not an object.
That's part of the force of the use of the word concept. Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you. It's, of course, a picture because good luck.